start with this intertemporal interactive decisions, but also I will need some formulas, which I was telling yesterday on my lecture. So, but I didn't have this on my slides, and I write them. Because not everyone was at the previous lecture. So I will start with, well, we also will have one very more or less simple example and explain what, again, also in very simple cases, what conclusions we can make using game theory, using game theoretical modeling. Actually, this example is I describe this model from a real life situation which happens in 1975 when I was first elected as dean of the faculty. I had to explain to my chef, to the rector, that some decisions were wrong. And this is one of the examples how game theory helps me to do this. So consider such a rhomboidal situation. So we have here four players, player A0, B1, B2, and player C. A0 is the top center who regulates the behavior of B1 and B2, and B1, they can influence the behavior of C. B2 also influences the behavior of C. So it's like a rhomboidal control system. How this system works, and the problem is whether such control systems can really operate in real life, whether they are effective or not. So that means that it's like to have one servant if two persons have one servant.
Okay, one servant, two
people. For two persons, yes? So, we know that this is very ineffective, but game theoretical can show, and in real life situations, we have many, sometimes such things. For instance, in the university, in our university, we have the rector, we have two faculties, for instance, physics and mathematics, for instance, and C maybe is computer center, which is controlled by these two faculties, yes? And how this operates, whether can such system effectively operate. I have shown to our rector this is ineffective. And we can see from the theory. Player A0 is the chief, the top chief. He is on the highest level. He selects a strategy, U1, U2, which from his strategy set, and this strategy restricts the possibilities of players B1 or B2 who are on the second level. In other words, the set of choices for player B1 depends upon the parameter U1. And the set of choices of player B2 depends upon the parameter B2. So using U1 and U2, player A0 regulates the possibilities of players B1 and B2. But then there is a player, the seventh player, which is on the third level, and player B1 selects some control, W1, and with this control, he regulates the possibilities of player C. And B2 also selects some control, W2, and regulates the possibilities of player C. So thus, the set of all strategies of possibilities of player C depends upon two parameters, omega-1 and omega-2, which are selected by B1 and B2. Now, suppose V is some production program which is selected by player C. So this is some strategy of player C. He he is producing something. Or if this computer center, he is serve, he produce software. Yes, and the payoff of player C depends upon what he is producing, and also the payoff of all other players also depends upon the production of C, because he is seven, he is beginning, the other people do not. So we have that we have four payoff functions for four players. I1 is the payoff function of the top level player A0. I2 and I3 are payoffs of second level players on second level, B1, B2, and this is the third level players on second level. Now, suppose this is the, so let's see how this is really looking, this system is really looking. So, the strategy V, which is selected by player C, depends upon the set from which he is selected. Yes? So it depends, that means that it depends upon the restrictions which are made by the player B1, upon the restrictions which are made by player B2, and these restrictions themselves depend upon what player A0 selects. So we have this, we see that this function of each player depends upon parameters which are chosen by all the players. So we have this four player game, and with this payoff functions, so this payoff function of each player, and these are the players. Now, what is the optimal solution in this game? Yes, what is the optimal solution in this game? So I will not go in details further. So the player on the lowest level, on the lowest level, player C, he is selecting V is in his strategy, as function of W1, W2, U1, and U2. And he is maximizing his payoff by selecting the best V, is maximizing over V. But this optimal V is function of these parameters. So I'll write here. So his optimal V is function of these parameters. One. So the optimal strategy of player C is his maximum, but it depends upon this one. Now, how the players B1 and B2 are behaving? Their payoffs depend also upon V. They take in account that the player C will behave optimally, and they put his optimal strategy in their payoff function. So their payoffs will be A, take 2, B dash, and maybe 1, B1, maybe 2, U2. So their payoffs depend on the payoffs are functions of U1, U2, and W1, W2, which they are selecting themselves. So the same, the next player, this is the player B1, this is the player B2. Here's the payoff is B dash. How must they behave, these two players? You see, we see here that the payoff of player I2 depends not only upon strategy of player B1, but depends also upon strategy of player B2. And also here, the payoff of player B2 doesn't depend only upon his own strategy. It depends also upon strategy W1. So we have here the simultaneous two-person non-zero-sum game. And we have to find Nash equilibrium. So the solution of this is Nash equilibrium. So denote this Nash equilibrium by dash. Suppose we find some Nash equilibrium. But then player A0, which has his function is like this, is his function, he knows this Nash equilibrium. This everything is already fixed. He is just maximizing his payoff over U1 and U2. It seems, how to say, easy to operate. But the problem is, this Nash equilibrium on the second level is very difficult task. It may not be easy. It may have many Nash equilibrium and so on and so on. So in practical life, in practical situation, this system will not operate. The optimal way of operating with such system is practically impossible. Because this second level solution is very difficult. So this is just an example that one must not construct such control systems. It gives a radical explanation of this. Yes. Now, what can give us also? Now, let's come now to the multi-stage games. We want to consider the decision-making dynamics. For this, first, I give an example also. Consider the following example. We have here only three stages. The first player moves on the first stage. He selects left or right direction. Then the second player is moving. And then once more the first player. And these are the payoffs. This is the zero-sum game. Zero-sum game. Now, this is the game with perfect information. So on each stage, the player knows where he is. So being on this stage, for instance, player one knows that on the first stage he selects left, and that the second player on the second stage selects right. In the same time also here. So all the motions are known. Now, let's understand, what is strategy in this game? What's the strategy of player in such kind of game? The strategy has to prescribe to the player what to do under every information he has. So he must know what to do. The first player must know what to do here. He must know to go left or right. So the strategy has to prescribe him what to do. And he must know what to do in this position, go left or right, or this, or this. So the strategy is five-dimensional vector. It's vector of this type. Where this is zero, right or left, right or left, right or left. So we have 32 strategies. So the first player has 32 strategies, different possibilities. Now, what is the strategy of the second player? The second player he moves only in two points. He can go left or right in each of these points. So he has only four strategies. Yesterday I spoke about the matrix games. So if we want to construct a matrix game which corresponds to this game, we should have game with a matrix of a big matrix. But what is interesting, that in this game solution is very easy. Solution comes by backward induction. So in this position, the player one has to choose right because he's minus three, he's maximizing. Player here, he has to choose left. Here he has to choose left. Here to choose left. The second player, because he's minimizing, he has to choose. He is minimizing, so he has to choose. He has to choose left because he is interesting. No, yes, his payoff is minus, so he has to choose left here. And here, the second player has to choose also left. And then the first player here has to choose right, because here he gets four. So the solution is very simple. It is settled. But what we see that in this game, we have pure strategy settled. You remember yesterday I told that not every game has pure strategy settled. We have to use mixed strategies. But in this is a case we don't need to use mixed strategies. So in the game of perfect information, we can use pure strategies. We don't need to throw coins or whatever I have shown yesterday with these small pieces of papers. We don't need it. But now let's consider some other setting on the same game tree. Suppose that player 2 on the second stage doesn't know what the first player does. And the first player on the third stage doesn't know what the second player does and forget what he also does. It's possible. I also forget sometimes. Then we have this game. The game will look like this. You see, we connect these two positions of the second player in one because he cannot distinguish. He's here or here. He can't distinguish because he didn't know what the first player does. So for him, these two positions are equivalent. Also, the first player didn't know what the second player does, so he can't distinguish these two positions. He forgot what he does. So all these four positions for him are the same, as looking equivalent, because he didn't know. Now, what is the strategy in this game? The strategy is, of course, the functional information. The player cannot choose his action according to the position where he is, because he didn't know where he is. He knows only that he is in this set. So his strategy must be function of this set. So in this case, how many strategies have the first player? The first player has here, he can choose left or right here, and left or right here. He has only four strategies. So the first player has four strategies. Four strategies. And how many strategies has the second player? The second player only has two strategies, left or right. Because he knows he's here or here is here. Both these vertices for him are the same. So we have here 4/2 matrix. So the big game, 30/4, reduces to a smaller game, which is much easier to solve. Because the players didn't know what to do. They didn't know where they are. From this we have very important conclusion. Very important conclusion, which the politicians not understand. Not only politicians. 99% of managers don't understand. The very important conclusion. That it is much easier to take decisions if we don't know anything. It's better not to know. It's better not to have information. It's easier to make decisions. So this small matrix game. This is a huge matrix game. But now, you know, they select data, databases, huge databases. They don't know what to do with the database. So many information is not necessary. Of course, you know that for blind men, it's easier to find a wife than for not blind men, yes? If we write this matrix, payoff matrix here, for this game, is this one. Is this payoff matrix. Very simple matrix. And we see that practically these two rows dominate, because here the first player gets more. So practically it's 2/2 matrix. But what we see here, but life is not so easy. It's not so easy. If we don't know, we have another difficulties. There is no pure strategy equilibrium. Here we have only mixed strategies. we have to use mixed strategies. If we have no information, we're doing this. And so we have this mixed strategy, 4 over 7, 3 over 7 for the second player, and 0, 0, 4 over 7, 3 over 7 for the first player. So this is some difference. So we have here the central point in mixed strategies. This is the this is what kind of new situations we get when you consider dynamic games. In dynamic games, like this one, is very important the information about the state. About we have to know what. In which position we are at each stage of the game. If we know everything very well, as perfect information, we have a game with perfect information, which is very huge, difficult to solve, but solution is a pure strategy solution. Like chess has the solution in pure strategies. There's the famous theorem of Zermelo, 1911, proved. But nobody knows the solution, it's impossible to find. But there is pure strategy solution. But in the games with incomplete information, they are much easier. But the solution is a mixed strategies. We don't have pure strategy solution. Then now I want to go to another point concerning some. Now I start with some aspects of time consistency. How much time I think about this?
You can take another 15.
Yeah. Now, let's consider the general multi-stage game. So how this with perfect information. So we have a graph tree. We have a tree, and on this tree you have the set of vertices. We have this. This set of axes we split into n plus 1 different sets, this x1, x2, xn plus 1. x1 is the set of vertices where the first player is moving, x2 where the second player is moving, and so on. Yes. And the players, the game proceeds by choosing the next vertex in each set. So, and on each stage, the player gets some payoff on each stage of the game. So I better show here. We have the tree like graph, one which I already showed. Maybe here is going the first player, here the first player, here the second player, here the third player, maybe here also the first, here maybe the second, the third, and so on. So we have all the vertices, there are some vertices in which the one player is moving, some vertices in which another. So we have n players. And the game proceeds in the following way. The player, first player, selects left or right, here. One of the vertices, then they move on in the next vertex. Here also the same player, is moving left or right. Then the second player chooses left or right. Then the third player left or right, and so on and so on. So this is the game of the graph thing, dynamic game with complete information. And in each vertex, they know what to do. They know where they are. So the game is with perfect information. And the strategy is in the function of these points, where they are. So, the strategy of player prescribes him what to do in each vertex where he is moving. This is the strategy. So in such game, as I told you already, it is proved that there is an equilibrium in pure strategies from theorem. So generalization of theorem of Zermelo. Now the Nash equilibrium always existed, but the interesting thing is the cooperation. As I told on my previous lecture, in cooperative, when the players cooperate, they try to find such n tuple of strategies which maximize the sum of the payoffs. Now suppose they find such strategies and they find the so-called cooperative trajectory. This is the trajectory on which the sum of the payoffs is maximal. Suppose they find such trajectory. Now let's see what is happening along this trajectory. So in cooperative games there are different solution concepts. I told also yesterday about the core and the Shapley value. The Shapley value is the most accepted solution concept because it always exists, it is unique, so it's easy to handle with this. I just remind the formula of Shapley value. So each player according to Shapley value has to get this amount. This is the sum. Maximize the sum of the payoffs. So they have to move along this trajectory. 2, 2, 2. Because here we have 6. The sum is 6. Here the sum is 3. This is the sum 1.5. The sum is here 1 only. Yes. So the maximal sum is along this trajectory. This is a cooperative trajectory. They have to move along. When they move to cooperative trajectory, they have to. The main concept in cooperative game theory is how to divide this total payoff. Each player must know how he will get, because they are going and maximizing the sum. But it doesn't mean that player will get 2. Nobody will give him 2, because it depends everything upon his power. He will get according to the Shapley value. So they have to compute this VR test. It's easy to do. Now, if we compute Shapley value for this game, we get this amount. So in this game, in the beginning, they have to get the, no, this in X, X, U, yes, in X1, yes. Yes, so the Shapley value in the whole game is like this. So the first player has to get this amount, something close to 1, and this are the amount of the next players. So the next players are getting more than the first player. This is the rule which Shapley value gives. We shall not discuss this. Yes. On the next stage, if we compute once more Shapley value coming here, this will be like that. And on the next stage, the Shapley value will be like this. So we see that the Shapley value changes from stage to stage. So in the beginning, if we suppose in the beginning we decide to go this way, then I'm expecting to get my component of, suppose I am the second player, suppose. Then I'm expecting, according to our contract, I'm expecting to get, say 91 over 36. Because this is my component of Shapley value. I'm expecting to get this number. But after the first stage, the people can say, well, let's look once more what's going on. And I see that I'm getting another amount already. And on the next stage, another amount. So I'm not sure in what I will get. So this time inconsistency. This happens in these cooperative games. Very often, it's very often a situation. So if we have some agreement in the beginning, we are not sure that this agreement will give the same result on the next stage of the game. This time it exists. How to make that this will hold? We have to make some payments. So we would like that the total amount which I get in three stages, which is here Shapley value, which the, my component of Shapley value, will be so that after the first stage, the amount which I will get after the first stage, together with something, will be equal to the first step. So how to do that? My payoffs will remain the same. I have to pay this difference to the players on each stage. Stage payments. I must make stage payments, something like salary. So that in the whole game I will get what I proposed to have in the beginning. So these are so-called stage payments, which we call the Shapley value distribution procedure. So such payments have to be made on each stage so that the situation will be stable, that the players stay in cooperation. But we see what is bad here. Sometimes we have to get negative, to pay negative amounts. To ensure stability, we have to pay some negative amounts. So this is some problem which is very serious in dynamic games. So in dynamic cooperation games, practically all dynamic cooperative games, we don't have this stability. Time consistency, obviously. Any agreement which is achieved in the beginning will never hold if we don't care on each stage to make some special regulations so that this agreement will hold. So this is one of the important consequences when you analyze dynamic games. So on the next, after I will speak only about this.